how do I spend my lifetime? What will I leave behind? What really matters in my life? Will I leave a trace behind? And how can I deal with the memories that are a heavy load on my shoulders for this or that reason? How can I manage to find a new identity and things like that? And these are the connections, and these are like just human questions that are part of all lives of all people on earth.
It's something that we share, actually, no matter where we come from. We deal with the same questions.
And I think this is of course he gets involved in a similar way as I did, and starting to help without wanting to help. But this is always the question: if you don't see someone drowning somewhere, you can manage to not look at it. Mm-hmm. But if someone is like in a difficult existential situation, right, be on your side, and or is, became a friend, and you know him or her, and then you will, without any thoughts of being a good person, you will just help, mm-hmm. or you will just try to make it better.
Yeah, but before that, you actually have to make a step forward and start talking to someone, start talking to a refugee. And in the book for Richard, this isn't easy at first. And also, I had the feeling also for the refugees he's talking to, this isn't easy. There is a kind of uncertainty on both sides. So was this also your experience, that you have to like find a way to connect to each other?
Naja, as in my experience, at least the people that were willing to talk to me, which were not all, of course, they wanted to tell their stories, and they the hardest part was unexpectedly that to speak about their happy past was the most difficult thing to do. So when I would ask how was it in the childhood, who were your parents, and what was your daily routine as a child, and which school did you attend, and things like that, and the memories of this happy life came up, this was the hardest part. And
because it was too confronting, or?
Yeah, because they always know that this is lost forever. Even if they manage to survive here, or even if they manage to get the right documents, it will never be like this. And even if they have own children one day, the cut in the biography will always stay with them. Mm-hmm. So also in the childhood of their children, because also one of the questions is will you teach your children, if you have some, your home language, or what songs would you sing to your children, and things like that. And we all in Europe, we know that emigration is not a question of one generation, but of two or three or four generations. You know, it sticks to the people, and you cannot just get rid of it. When you remember the time where everything was in its place, so to say, even if not that rich or happy life, but in the right place in the life, and you know this will never come back, this is hard to stand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because actually when we read these stories of the refugees, it hasn't been all misery, it hasn't been all bad. They actually had good lives, happy moments, and there was always some point where something destroyed this.
Yeah, and the moments are different from person to person. So the people I spoke with were one grew up without any parents, like he was given by his parents to another family, or was he didn't know if he was sold as a child, or if he was just given, or if his parents died, so he was like an orphan. Mm-hmm. But he was in the wrong family, and the family was not a good one for him. They beat him, and they, he said he was like a slave. Mm-hmm. But there was also someone who was running a business first in Nigeria. Then there were fights between the Christian and Muslim people, and the house was burned down, and he had to leave the country. Then he started anew in Libya. He founded another business. And then he again the civil war in Libya destroyed the business. Not only the business, he was forced to, or he was put on a boat actually with his children, and he was forced to flee. But he had a lot of experience. He attended school in Nigeria. He has had his own family. He was a businessman. So he knew what he did, and there are different kinds of people. Some were very young when they were forced to cross the Mediterranean, and some were older, you know. Some were poor, some had a normal life. One told me he has lived in a house with like 6 or 8 rooms with his father, and they often had guests, and you know, it was a normal life. And I thought this is also one of the things that connect us to these people and make very clear that the loss of the normal life can happen all of a sudden, and it makes it imaginable that it also could happen to us. And I think this is the most important thing to make it possible, that you can imagine yourself in the place of someone like this, that we all know that situations can change from, historic situations can change from one day to the next, and that at least in my family, all of us were forced for this or that reason to flee or to emigrate or to change places. And
this is actually a connection that we also have in the book, because Richard starts to think that actually he himself has been a refugee as a baby.
Yeah, it's there's a story that actually happened to my mom. I don't know if it's good to tell you this, but
go ahead.
Somehow all the things are my experience, otherwise I couldn't write about it. So my mom was when the family came from East Prussia, mm-hmm. and
modern day Poland, we would say.
But yeah, it had been Poland, yeah.
A part of Germany, yeah. Back then.
And the family was asked if they want to stay Germans, then they had to leave, or if they want to become Polish. And so my great-grandmother thought, oh, it's her responsibility to make this decision. And my grandmother, she was in Siberia in a camp as war prisoner, just taken from the street and put into the camp. So my great-grandmother, she thought, okay, this is a great responsibility, better we become, we stay Germans. So they left. And then there was the situation on the platform in some station that my great-grandmother with the two older children was already in the train, and my mom, as a 3-year-old girl, she was outside the train. And all of a sudden, my great-grandmother realized, oh, oops, the third child is outside. And then there was a Soviet soldier, and she asked him to give her the child, and she was given over the heads of all the people on the platform into the window of the train. So this was my mom's story. Mm-hmm. And I was always very impressed, because I really was... I was happy for my relief for my mom, mm-hmm. that they managed. Yeah.
In 1 second or 1 minute, it could have been a totally different life for your mother, actually.
Yeah, and there were so many children that that didn't make it in such situations, and I think you all know about these called like wolves. The one book is called also Wolves Kids or something like that. So they were in Poland for this or that reason without family, small ones also and bigger ones, and they would make groups and live in the woods and try to organize some food for themselves, and they were just on their own. They were like wild children. Mm. Also they grew up in a way, but I think it wasn't very easy under these circumstances. So it could easily have happened to my mom. And so these moments can make a difference.
Mm-hmm. Moments can make a difference. That is actually the red line throughout all these stories of the refugees Richard is meeting. And I would want to focus on one of them, which is Rashid in the novel, but he is actually based on someone that you have met in Berlin and who also played an important role in this protest camp at the Oranienplatz, and that was Bashir. Who was Bashir?
Naya, Bashir was the one I spoke about now with the two children, mm-hmm. and who had founded the two businesses in Nigeria and in Libya. And he, children, when his boat capsized, and then when he arrived in Europe, he would call his wife. Because she was somewhere else, she had stayed in Libya. And she would ask him what happened to the children, and when he told her, she would say, "You didn't look after them well enough, so I will get divorced from you." Mm-hmm. And from this moment on, he was in Europe without his kids, with all the memories, with the responsibility, and you know the feeling that he failed, and why he did survive and not the kids, and so on and so on. And then he was one of the real political leaders of this Oranienplatz group, and I think the only he was a charismatic and very, very good person, and everyone who met him knew this immediately because he was like a big one, you know, he was a real Kerl. So, and he had a warm heart, and he was really, he really tried hard to that the people on the Oranienplatz became aware of being a political group. So if someone would sell t-shirts saying like no one is illegal or something like that, privately, just to make money, he would say, "No, we are a group, and this is not just for making money, so we do it all together in our actions," and so on and so on. And
he became a bit of the leader of this group of refugees living there.
And nobody from the Berlin Senate would ever meet him. Mm-hmm. You know, he was, I always said, like a president without a country. Mm-hmm. So the people that he was president of came from different countries, and you know, it was like a mixed group. So there was no real There was no talk to him
he wasn't considered a spokesman by the official authorities.
So. Yeah, he applied for being heard, but mm-hmm. Three times he went to the Senate, and they would say, "No, we don't have time." You know,
because
I think the tragedy was that in the end he really tried hard to organize jobs for his people and to make them survive and
believe. Because this is important to state, those people that were in Berlin They were actually not allowed to stay in Berlin, allowed to work in Berlin.
They were allowed to work in Italy, where they landed in Lampedusa. And so, you know, where you, the Dublin regulations say where you, the country where you arrive is the only country where you are allowed to work. Mm-hmm. But we also know that in Italy there is no work. So they just try to survive and to apply for being allowed to work in Germany, where they knew that there were jobs that they could do. And in the end, he said yes to a paper that was offered him from the Senate, a paper saying that if they leave the Oranienplatz, they would be supported by developing their Arbeitsleben. Also they would get some support for the career and for their working life. Mm-hmm. And of course they left the Oranienplatz, and afterwards was very clear that unfortunately nobody could be helped, because they figured out in a long process of 3 months that they came via Lampedusa. What everybody knew before, of course, this was the problem. So they figured out they came via Lampedusa, and so they said, "Ah, oh, you have to go back to Italy." And this was the result of signing the paper. Mm-hmm. And this was some of the more radical people on the Oranienplatz didn't like Bashir signing the paper, because they knew in advance that it would be like this, but they were just desperate and exhausted from these 2 years living in tents, all the rats running around, and you know, it was sometimes it was winter and snow on the tents, and the tents would break down, and so it was a situation that they just didn't stand any longer. And he tried to make the best of it, and he trusted the people, and this was a mistake.
And then, I've read in one of your other books that has been published since, I found an article that you've written in Der Spiegel, which is actually kind of a sad epilogue for those who have read the book and have met Rashid, also Bashir, in the book. Because he died, and you wrote an obituary, so what happened then next after this whole process that you just described?
He was suffering from a heart disease, and he one day after he so he got some kind of paper because of his heart disease, and so in a way we managed to organize a real apartment for him after almost 10 years of traveling around. The first thing he did was that he took other people inside his 1.5 room apartment of 40 square meters, other people that weren't so lucky as he was and had no place to stay. So he took 8 people in his apartment. 4 of them were family, parents and 2 kids. And the others were 1 student and 1 from the Oranienplatz, and so on and so on. Everyone who would ask Bashir for a place, he would say, okay, move in. And so, and then some weeks before he died, he called me and he said, "Jenny, please try to find a place for the family at least." He loved children, and he wanted to have children again. But it was just too much in the 1.5 room apartment. And then we managed to find something for the family, but it was on the way. And then one day he would just fell down and die. Mm. It was just too much for his heart. And he didn't take care for himself. So when there was a demonstration, he would always stand up and speak loudly and be strong and so on and so on. He would never say, oh, I'm sick, I'll just stay behind and I will be silent. No, he was never silent, and he was a strong person, and so he just didn't make it.
Yeah. It's like an accumulation of all the psychological tension that has been there for all these years, being a refugee, but all of a sudden.
Yeah.
Because this is also something that we cross throughout the book, in every story, that we actually are not aware of this as a European, how much psychological tension there is in not having a place to stay and not having a job. And even in very small things like the culture shock of coming to a new continent, you have some examples of that in the book too.
Now, I think that the main problem is not only the difficult situation, how to make a living and where to stay, but the combination of this situation and the question of identity that you have inside after coming from somewhere else in the course of violent things. What I learned from one of the refugees was the question was the idea that he said he became a stranger to himself, not only a stranger in terms of like being a stranger in a new society, but also to himself, because he lost all the things that founded his identity, like the family, the place, the house, the daily life, his job, and so on. So all the things that form ourselves and that give us the feeling of to be this or that person, he lost. And then he said, who am I? I have no picture of myself anymore. And it was not the photo what he meant, but the idea of himself was lost. And this was one of the moments when I really understood what they mean, that the to be a stranger is not only outside but also inside. An important question.
Mm-hmm. Also coming here and noticing that actually no one cares for you. You've become invisible, because this is the name of the action that they started at Oranienplatz. We become visible.
Yeah, they wanted to become visible. This was the reason to found this camp on the Oranienplatz. But it's very hard to be seen.
Why is it so hard to be seen?
In a way, I think because the question is, why don't we want to see people like these? I think in a way we think it is too much for us to be solved, so it cannot be solved. And the things that cannot be solved, they are like uncanny. I would say they are like something that infects our own lives. That we always try to find to make sense of the things we are doing, and to have some security, as a security or safe in our lives, so that we you know, we are on a planet and we know the universe and we are very lonely and so on. And so we try to make sense of our existence. But when we see that someone without his own fault can be just thrown out of his life and be really lost, it means that also we can be really lost and we don't want to see it. I think this is the deepest reason for not be willing to see it. And of course, it is if you start dealing with these things, it takes a lot of time and it's endless, and it makes you desperate in many moments. Mm-hmm. Because there are no solutions, and to face a situation that has no solution is always very hard. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Actually, you proposed to read a part of the book. The only thing is, we didn't organize this, so you have...
My mistake. I was too late.
But we have the part in German, and so how many people of you would be okay if we read just the text in German.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
I guess we can do this.
We could have done the interview in German. And then I will read.
Yeah. They are waiting for it.
I'm going to read a passage which is in the second half of the book. By the way, it's the character I'm speaking about here is in the book is Apoll, and the real person behind Apoll is the one who was drawing the beautiful design of the cover of my book, which is I'm very happy that the Dutch version took the same cover as the German one. This is a when I asked him how he's a Tuareg and he used to travel with a caravan, and when I asked him what are you doing with the camels at night so that they don't run away, he would say the big camels, they know already that they stay, and the small camels, the baby camels, we build like a fence for them, and this is the fence for the baby camels. And now I'm reading a passage about him. And Richard is I had asked him to help him with his garden work. Den ganzen Sommer lag das Boot am Steg, aber wegen des toten Mannes im See, der someone drowned in the lake. Aber wegen des toten Mannes im See hat Richard es kein einziges Mal benutzt. In den letzten Nächten hat es ein paar Mal kräftig geregnet. Seither ist das Boot voller Wasser und es fehlt nicht viel, dann würde es sinken. Wie einen betrunkenen Walfisch ziehen die beiden Männer den Kahn zum Ufer hin, damit er Grund hat und sie auf die Ruderbank steigen können zum Schöpfen. Sage mal, wann genau bist du geboren? Fragt Richard. 91, sagt Apoll. Richard hat sich das schon so gedacht. Und in welchem Monat? Am 1. Januar. 8 Monate nach dem Massaker, nach dem Tuareg-Aufstand in Niger, von dem er gestern seinen Freunden erzählt hat. Das denkt Richard, sagt es aber nicht. Er sagt, pünktlich zum Feuerwerk, da hast du Glück. Das legen die Italiener so fest, wenn es kein Dokument gibt. Verstehe, sagt Richard. Dann schöpfen sie eine Weile. Sage einmal, fängt Richard nach einer Weile wieder an, im Internet habe ich, I must say, this is eine Weile, this is a mistake, and I'm sure I have corrected it for the novel, but this is because I forget the real physical book. I took it from my computer, and now you will hear my mistakes. This is a world premiere. I'm sorry for the Weile. Also, sage einmal, fängt Richard wieder an. Im Internet habe ich gesehen, dass ihr sehr tiefe Brunnen grabt. Und dann zieht ein Esel die Eimer mit Wasser nach oben. Ist das wirklich so? Ja, sagt Apoll, so lang wie das Seil ist, an dem der Kanister hängt, so weit muss der Esel gehen. Und dann wieder zurück. Jeden Tag macht man das 3-4 Stunden. Aber das ist ganz schön mühsam. Das Vieh muss trinken. Warum rollt ihr das Seil nicht auf mit so einem Gestell? Das hält im Sand nicht. Dann ist es gefährlich, diese Brunnen zu graben? Ja, es wurden schon viele verschüttet. Auf runden Hölzern, Stücken von einem zersägten Baum, die sie unterlegen, rollen sie nun das Boot über das Gras bis an den Rand der Wiese. Richard hat gestern gelesen, dass durch die enormen Mengen an Wasser, die nötig sind, um das Uran aus dem Stein zu spülen, sich der Grundwasserspiegel rings um die Minen merklich abgesenkt hat. Kennst du Arlit? Klar, meine Gegend, sagt der Paul. Da ist eine berühmte Uranmine, wo Frankreich Uran fördert. Bald wird die Welt von neuem Gelegenheit haben, von den Tuareg zu sprechen, da der französische Minister das begonnene Werk mit Nachdruck fortzusetzen gedenkt. Wenn früher oder später der Plan einer Sahara-Bahn verwirklicht werden und das schnaubende Dampfross als Rival des flinken Kamels auf dem Sande der Wüste erscheinen wird, werden wohl die Söhne der Wüste trübe Erfahrungen machen. Sie werden die Kultur aufhalten wollen, Aber man wird ihre Angriffe mit wohlgezieltem Pelotonfeuer und Branntwein zurückweisen, bis sie wie die Indianer Amerikas ihr Land den Zivilisierten überlassen. Das hatte man 1881 in der Gartenlaube, kurz nach der Erfindung des Journalismus, geschrieben. Aus der Sahara-Bahn war dann zwar nichts geworden, aber knapp 100 Jahre später hatten die Franzosen in ihrer ehemaligen Kolonie stattdessen ebenso ungeniert den Uranabbau in Angriff genommen. Kultur, denkt Richard. Fortschritt, denkt er. Er sagt, pass auf, du gibst das Boot an und ich halte es auf der anderen Seite. Während er das Boot hält, holt Apoll die runden Hölzer, um sie unter das Boot zu legen. Dann lassen sie es beide zusammen langsam hinunter, bis es verkehrt herumliegt. Aber du hast nicht in Alit in einer Mine gearbeitet, oder? Nein, wir hatten Kamele. Du bist mit der Karawane gezogen? Ja. Womit habt ihr gehandelt? Wir haben die Kamele nach Libyen verkauft. Von welchem Alter an hast du das gemacht? So ab 10. Ab 10 geht man mit den Männern. Wie lange ist so eine Karawane unterwegs? Ein paar Monate, manchmal ein Jahr. Mitten durch die Wüste? Ja. Und wie findet ihr da den Weg? Wir kennen ihn. Ja, aber wie? Der junge Tuareg zuckt mit den Schultern. Wir kennen ihn. Richard würde es gern verstehen. Immer noch steht er da neben dem umgedrehten Ruderboot mit dem jungen Mann, der 3.500 Kilometer zurückgelegt hat, um ihm bei der Gartenarbeit zu helfen. Seht ihr es an den Sternen? Ja. Und tagsüber, wenn keine Sterne da sind? I'm not well organized. Und tagsüber, wenn keine Sterne da sind? Die Männer wissen, was auf dem Weg passiert ist. Was wann auf dem Weg passiert ist. Immer. Jemals? Ja. Sie erzählen es? Ja. Beim Gehen? Wir gehen ja nicht, wir reiten. Ah ja. Abends werden die Geschichten erzählt. Aber sie erkennen den Weg an den Geschichten. Ja. Sie erkennen ihn durch ihre Erinnerung. Ja. Richard verstummt. Natürlich hat er immer gewusst, dass zum Beispiel die Odyssee und die Ilias, bevor Homer oder wer auch immer sie zum ersten Mal aufgeschrieben hat, mündlich weitergegebene Erzählungen waren. Aber noch nie ist ihm der Zusammenhang zwischen Raum, Zeit und Dichtung so klar gewesen wie in diesem Moment. Vor dem Hintergrund einer Wüste sah man es nur besonders deutlich, aber im Prinzip war es doch an keinem Ort auf der Welt je anders. Ohne Erinnerung war der Mensch nur ein Stück Fleisch auf einem Planeten. Und dann haken sie noch die Wiese und dann bringen sie die Gartenmöbel von der Terrasse unter das Schuppendach, stecken das Surfbrett, das Richard in diesem Sommer kein einziges Mal ausprobiert hat, in eine Hülle, bringen das Bruchholz aus dem Wald zur Feuerstelle hinüber und bauen den Grill ab. Dann zahlt Richard dem Flüchtling, der genauso aussieht, wie er sich Apoll immer vorgestellt hat, 50 Euro. Danke. Applaus. Yes.
In the piece that you were reading, you were mentioning a French firm who is actually looking for uranium right in the neighborhood of the Tuaregs, where they actually live. I guess in the book you have the question also, do we in Europe actually have to care about all these refugees? Is it actually our problem?
Naja, I think the problem is that we used to look at just this moment of history in which we live. But the process of that ends up now in the refugee camps in Libya or in Europe or in these boats or in our cities has started long ago. Like, as we can see here, like 150 or 200 years ago. And I think it's also necessary to think of the future in longer terms, like 100 and 200 years. It's not just a question of our lifetime that we have to find a good solution for, but also the lifetime of our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, because the things, the structures that have been destroyed by the European people when they were arriving in African countries, the destruction of the societies that were already there and had high cultures and were highly developed, and the only problem was that they didn't have as good weapons as the Europeans had, but we know little about their long histories that they had before the Europeans arrived, and much of these structures have, I would say, like almost all of these structures have been infected at least or destroyed by the colonialists, also the first ones that arrived and also later on. When we look at the map, we can see that the borders are drawn by European people just like this. So they have nothing to do with the populations that were there. For instance, the Tuareg, are Berber people. So they have a history that reaches back to like 3,000 years before Christ or something like that. It's completely mad. We have no idea about it. Even the Greek people learned something from these people, the Tuareg people, and then they were not given an own country. Mm-hmm. And until now, the whole area is infected by them having lost their area, which is now divided into like three countries. Mm-hmm. Algeria and Niger and Mali. So they are the Tuareg people, and they are fighting for their own country. They will want to found an own country that is called Azawad. Mm-hmm. So they are struggling with the government of Niger, and Niger is making business with France and don't deliver the money that they get from France to the Tuareg people, because they use it for their own affairs, and the money that they get from France is also not that much. And we always know that the Europeans, they are not teaching their knowledge to people in the African countries so that they could be on their own and make an own production, perhaps not of uranium especially, but also of other things. So there is no idea of teaching them without egotism. Mm-hmm. It's always like, okay, they are taught as much as they need to work in a Siemens company, mm-hmm. but they are not taught that much to found their own Siemens company with an African name. So this, I think, is also one of the problems.
Yeah, we have to conclude because we're running out of time as predicted. But I was wondering, because you've shared your opinion on this whole thing that we've been dealing with, this refugee crisis, the responsibilities we have. But if we look at the election results in the latest years in Germany, in the Netherlands, in Austria, a lot of people don't share your opinion on that. They have the feeling, well, my home doesn't feel like my home anymore too, because they are all coming here. How do you look at this evolution?
Naja, we all know, even as we only look at our families or at perhaps our personal lives, that if the psychologists would say the pressure that is made by suffering, if the pressure made by suffering is big enough, something will happen or will change. And I think it is very short-sighted to say when we close the borders, everything will be fine. Or if we don't allow the ships to help people that are drowning in the Mediterranean, if we don't allow them anymore to save people, then the people won't come. Mm-hmm. This is wrong. Mm-hmm. They are still coming, but they are drowning now. And I think, of course, it is not a solution that all people are leaving their own countries. But if they are really suffering, they will always try to change their lives and to make it. This is very human, and we would do the same in the same situation. And I think if there's if there are many, many people suffering, and they can see now in the television that we have a nice life here, they won't stop. It won't stop, and the fence can be as high as like Melilla, and we know even this fence is sometimes climbed over. So this is not, it will infect our lives if you look long term. Mm-hmm. We have to deal with it in a good way, and we have to, I think, to enable the governments or you know the people in Africa to do their own thing. So for instance, if one of my friends is going to move back to Africa, and then he wants to buy a fridge here, and he wants to buy oil for cooking, and he wants to buy shampoo. And then I would ask him, why are you buying all this stuff here? You could buy it in your country. This doesn't make sense. And he says, yeah, it's so expensive in our country to buy this from Europe in Africa. And then I say, well, man, you can buy African shampoo or African fridge. Yeah, we don't have an own production. So it's like a bit like in Iceland. You know, Iceland is a bad example. No, I would say it's like an island that doesn't have any own industry, any own companies. I don't know, and so they import all the things, and then they of course are more expensive than they are here. But for me, it's completely mad to bring all this to Africa just because of some the price difference. I was shocked.
So am I. I think we have some work to do. I mean, we as society, world. And Jenny Erkenbeck has also some work to do because...
mentioned the book and the...
Yeah, CD. I was going to write now because I have gotten some chores there. But Jenny Erkenbeck will sign your books downstairs. And actually you have brought some things too that you... I mean, your books are for sale downstairs. What isn't for sale, that are the things that you have brought?
Yeah, I also brought something for sale. It's not that many, but I just wanted to let you know. And if there, if like hundreds want to buy it, we can manage. So just give me your address and we manage. So this is the second of the CDs I produced. So this is the first one. So this is the Tuareg, the Tuareg music I recorded because I thought it was very beautiful. This is Saleh Bacha is singing like solo with a drum, accompanied by a drum, and these are traditional songs. And the second CD, this is meanwhile there was a band founded, Blue Desert, and so he's part of the band, and on this CD for this CD they wrote own songs, and I translated the songs into German, and they are in the booklet. So it's about the change of life, being a refugee, all the difficulties, mm-hmm. And then I'm a saleswoman. I'm a haggard. And then I also brought two books because very good photographer. Katharina Billing is my best friend. And she started her own project while I was doing my research. And she accompanied my research by photographing all the situations on our way, like all the... yeah, you will see if you
all
see
the people. Book.
And her book was, she published like almost 1 year later than after my book already was published. So there are some photos in it that go beyond the story in my book, and might be interesting for some of you to see the real persons behind the story.
Absolutely,
good photos. Really.
So this is all downstairs. Give us like 3 minutes to get there. And thank you for inviting me.